Good afternoon. I hope you're doing well after the lunch. I have a tough job to do. You know, when I looked at the profile of the audience here, with their connotations on design, in all its forms, and with so much and so many people working on collaborative and networks and so on, that I wanted to tell you, I wanted to build an argument for primary education in a very specific context. In order to do that, in 20 minutes, I have to bring out four ideas. It's like four pieces of a puzzle. And if I succeed in doing that, maybe you would go back with a thought that that you could build on and perhaps help me do my work. The first piece of the puzzle is remoteness and the quality of education. By remoteness, I mean two or three different kinds of things. Of course, remoteness in its normal sense, which means that as you go further and further away from an urban center, you get to remoter areas. What happens to education? The second or a different kind of remoteness is that within the large metropolitan areas in all over the world, you have pockets like slums or shanty towns or poorer areas which are socially and economically remote from the rest of the city. So it's us and them. What happens to education in that context? So keep both of those ideas of remoteness. We made a guess. The guess was that schools in remote areas do not have good enough teachers. If they do have, they cannot retain those teachers. They do not have good enough infrastructure. And if they had some infrastructure, they have a difficulty maintaining it. But I wanted to check if this is true. So what I did last year was that I hired a car, looked up on Google, found a route into northern India from New Delhi, which did not cross any big cities or any big metropolitan centers, drove out about 300 kilometers, and wherever we found a school, I administered a set of standard tests, and then took those test results and plotted it on a graph. The graph was interesting, although you need to consider it carefully. I mean, this is a very small sample. This you should not generalize from it. But it was quite obvious or quite clear that for this particular route that I had taken, the remoter a school was, the worse its results seemed to be. That seemed a little damning. And I tried to correlate it with things like infrastructure or with the availability of electricity and things like that. To my surprise, it did not correlate. It did not correlate with the size of classrooms, did not correlate with the quality of the infrastructure, did not correlate with the poverty levels. It did not correlate. But what happened was that when I administered a questionnaire to each of these schools, with one single question for the teachers, which was, would you like to move to an urban metropolitan area? 69% of them said yes. And as you can see from that, they say yes, just a little bit out of Delhi, and they say no when you hit the rich suburbs of Delhi, because you know those are relatively better off areas. And then from 200 kilometers out of Delhi, the answer is consistently yes. I would imagine that a teacher who comes or walks into class every day thinking that I wish I was in some other school probably has a deep impact on what happens to the results. So it looked as though teacher motivation and teacher migration was a powerfully correlated thing with what was happening in primary schools, as opposed to whether the children have enough to eat and whether they're packed tightly into classrooms and that sort of thing. It appears that way. When you take educational technology, then I find in the literature that you know things like websites, collaborative environments, you've been listening to all that in the morning. It's always piloted first in the best schools, the best urban schools. And according to me, bias is the result. the literature, one part of it, the scientific literature, consistently blames ET as being overhyped and underperforming. The teachers always say, well, it's fine, but it's too expensive for what it does, because it's being piloted in a school where the students were already getting, let's say, 80% of whatever they could do. You put in this new super-duper technology, and now they get 83%. So the principal looks at it and says, 3% for, you know, $300,000, forget it. If you took the same technology and piloted it into one of those remote schools where the score was 30%, and let's say it took that up to 40%, that would be a completely different thing. So the relative change that ET, educational technology, would make would be far greater at the bottom of the pyramid than at the top, but we seem to be doing it the other way about. So I came to this conclusion that ET should reach the underprivileged first, not the other way about. And finally came the question of, how do you tackle teacher perception? Whenever you go to a teacher and show them some technology, the teacher's first reaction is, you cannot replace a teacher with a machine. It's impossible. I don't know why it's impossible, but even for a moment, if you did assume that it's impossible, I have a quotation from Sir Arthur C. Clarke, the science fiction writer whom I met in Colombo, and he said something which completely solves this problem. He said, a teacher that can be replaced by a machine should be. So, you know, it puts the teachers into a tough bind, you have to think. Anyway, so I'm proposing that an alternative primary education, whatever alternative you want, is required where schools don't exist, where schools are not good enough, where teachers are not available, or where teachers are not good enough, for whatever reason. If you happen to live in a part of the world where none of this applies, then you don't need an alternative education. So far, I haven't come across such an area, except for one case. I won't name the area, but somewhere in the world, people said, we don't have this problem because we have perfect teachers and perfect schools. There are such areas, but anyway, it doesn't. I'd never heard that anywhere else. I'm going to talk about children and self-organization, and a set of experiments which sort of led to this idea of what might an alternative education be like. They're called the hole-in-the-wall experiments, and I'll have to really rush through this. There are a set of experiments. The first one was done in New Delhi in 1999. And what we did over there was pretty much simple. I had an office in those days which bordered a slum, an urban slum. So there was a dividing wall between our office and the urban slum. So I cut a hole inside that wall, which is how this got the name Hole in the Wall, and put a pretty powerful PC into that hole, sort of embedded into the wall so that its monitor was sticking out at the other end. A touchpad, similarly embedded into the wall. Put in high-speed internet, put the Internet Explorer there, put it on altavista.com in those days, and just left it there. And this is what we saw. So that was my office in IIT. Here is the hole in the wall. About 8 hours later, we found this kid. To the right is this 8-year-old child who, and to his left is a 6-year-old girl who's not very tall. And what he was doing was he was teaching her to browse. So it sort of raised more questions than it answered. Is this real? Does the language matter? Because he's not supposed to know English. Will the computer last, or will they break it and steal it? And did anyone teach them? The last question was what everybody said, that, you know, I mean, they must have poked their head over the wall and asked the people in your office, can you show me how to do it? And somebody taught him. So I took the experiment out of Delhi and repeated it. This time in a city called Shivpuri, in the center of India, where I was assured that nobody had ever taught anybody anything. So it was a warm day. And the hole in the wall was on that decrepit old building. This is the first kid who came there. Later on, turned out to be a 13-year-old school dropout. He came there and he started to fiddle around with the touchpad. Very quickly noticed that when he moves his finger on the touchpad, something moves on the screen. And later on he told me, I have never seen a television where you can do something. So he figured that out, and took him over 2 minutes to figure out that he was doing things to the television. And then, as he was doing that, he made an accidental click by hitting the touchpad. You'll see him do that. He did that, and the Internet Explorer changed page. 8 minutes later, he looked from his hand to the screen, and he was browsing. He was going back and forth. When that happened, he started calling all the neighborhood children, like children would just say, come and see what's happening over here. And by the evening of that day, 70 children were all browsing. So 8 minutes and an embedded computer seemed to be all that we needed there. So we thought that this is what was happening, that children in groups can self-instruct themselves to use a computer and the internet. But under what circumstances? At this time, there was the main question was about English. People said, you know, you really ought to have this in Indian languages. So I said, what? Have what? Shall I translate the internet into some Indian language? That's not possible. So it has to be the other way about. But let's see, how do the children tackle the English language? I took the experiment out to northeastern India, to a village called Madan Tusi, where for some reason there was no English teacher. So the children had not learned English at all. And I built a similar hole in the wall. One big difference in the villages, as opposed to the urban slums, there were more girls than boys who came to the kiosk. In the urban slums, the girls tend to stay away. I left the computer there with lots of CDs. I didn't have any internet. And came back 3 months later. So when I came back there, I found this two kids, 8 and 12 year olds, who were playing a game on the computer. And as soon as they saw me, they said, we need a faster processor and a better mouse. So I was a little surprised about, you know, how on earth did they know all this? And they said, well, we've picked it up from the CDs. So I said, but how did you understand what's going on over there? So they said, well, you've left this machine which talks only in English, so we had to learn English. So then I measured, and they were using 200 English words with each other, mispronounced but correct usage, words like exit, stop, file, save, that kind of thing, not only to do with the computer but in their day-to-day conversations. So Madan Tusi seemed to show that language was not a barrier. In fact, they may be able to teach themselves the language if they really wanted to. Finally, I got some funding to try this experiment out to see if these results are replicable, if they happen everywhere else. And India is a good place to do such an experiment in, because we have all the ethnic diversities, all the, you know, the genetic diversity, all the racial diversities, and also all the socioeconomic diversities. So I could actually choose samples to cover a cross-section that would cover practically the whole world. So we went, I did this for almost 5 years, and this experiment really took us all the way across the length and breadth of India. This is the Himalayas. Up in the north, very cold. I also had to check or invent an engineering design which would survive outdoors. And I was using regular, normal PCs. So I needed different climates, for which India is also great, because we have very cold, very hot, and so on. This is the deserts to the west. Near the Pakistan border. And you see here a little clip of one of these villages. The first thing that these children did was to find a website to teach themselves the English alphabet. Then to central India, very warm, moist, fishing villages, where humidity is a very big killer of electronics. So we had to solve all the problems we had without air conditioning and with very poor power. So most of the solutions that came out used little blasts of air put at the right places to keep the machines running. I'm going to just cut this short. We did this over and over again. This sequence is also nice. This is a small child, 6 year old, telling his elder sister what to do. And this happens very often with these computers, that the younger children are found teaching the older ones. What did we find? We found that 6 to 13-year-olds can self-instruct in a connected environment irrespective of anything that we could measure. So if they have access to that computer, they will teach themselves, including intelligence. I couldn't find a single correlation with anything. But it had to be in groups. And that may be of great interest to this group, because all of you are talking about groups. So here was the power of what a group of children can do if you lift the adult intervention. We also established an engineering design in the process, which I will not talk about right now, but I have about a 75 to 80% uptime now using regular PCs embedded into village walls. Just a quick idea of the measurements. We took standard statistical techniques, so I'm going to not talk about that. But we got a clean learning curve, almost exactly the same as what you would get in a school. So I leave it at that because, I mean, it sort of says it all, doesn't it? What could they learn to do? Basic Windows functions, browsing, painting, chatting and email, games and educational material, music downloads, playing video. In short, what all of us does. And over 300 children would become computer literate and be able to do all of these things in 6 months with one computer. So how do they do that? If you calculated the actual time of access, it will work out to minutes per day. So that's not how it's happening. What you have actually is there is one child operating the computer. Surrounding him are usually three other children who are advising him on what they should do. If you test them, all four will get the same scores in whatever you ask them. Around these four are usually a group of about 16 children who are also advising, usually wrongly, about everything that's going on the computer. And all of them also will clear a test given on that subject. So they're learning as much by watching as they learn by doing. Seems counterintuitive to adult learning, but remember, 8-year-olds live in a society where most of the time they're told, don't do this. You know, don't touch the whiskey bottle. So what does the 8-year-old do? Observes very carefully how a whiskey bottle should be touched. And if you tested him, he would answer every question correctly on that topic. So they seem to be able to acquire very quickly. So what was the conclusion of all these 6 years of work was that primary education can happen on its own, or parts of it can happen on its own. It does not have to be imposed from the top downwards. It could perhaps be a self-organizing system. So I'll come back to several other experiments that we did on self-organized, self-instructional approaches. So that was the second bit that I wanted to tell you, that children can self-organize and attain an educational objective. The third piece was on values, and again, to put it very briefly, I conducted a test over 500 children spread across all over India, and asked them, gave them about 68 different values-oriented questions, and simply asked them their opinions. You got all sorts of opinions, yes, no, or I don't know. I simply took those questions where I got 50% yeses and 50% noes. So I was able to get a collection of 16 such statements. These were areas where the children were clearly confused because half said yes and half said no. A typical example being, sometimes it is necessary to tell lies. They don't have a way to determine which way to answer this question. Perhaps none of us do. So I leave you with this third question. Can technology alter the acquisition of values? Finally, self-organizing systems, about which, again, I won't say too much because you've been hearing all about it. Natural systems are all self-organizing, galaxies, molecules, cells, organisms, societies, except for the debate about intelligent designer. But at this point in time, as far as science goes, it's self-organization. I won't go into the sort of the official definitions, but other examples are traffic jams, stock market, society and disaster recovery, terrorism and insurgency. And you know about the internet-based self-organizing systems. So here are my four sentences then. Remoteness affects the quality of education. Educational technology should be introduced into remote areas first and other areas later. Values are acquired. Doctrine and dogma are imposed, the two opposing mechanisms. And learning is most likely a self-organizing system. If you put all the four together, then it gives, according to me, it gives us a goal, a vision for educational technology. An educational technology and pedagogy that is digital, automatic, fault-tolerant, minimally invasive, connected, and self-organized. As educationists, we've never asked for technology. We keep borrowing it. I mean, PowerPoint is supposed to be considered a great educational technology, but it was not meant for education. It was meant for making boardroom presentations. We borrowed it. Video conferencing, the personal computer itself. I think it's time that educationists made their own specs. And I have such a set of specs. This is a brief look at that. And such a set of specs should produce technology to address remoteness, values, and violence. So I thought I'd give it a name. Why don't we call it out-doctrination? And could this be a goal for educational technology in the future? So I want to leave that as a thought with you. Thank you.
Questions? Do you have any questions?
Do you have an opinion on the $100 computer?
Yes, actually.
What project?
Yes, I've been very, quite closely associated with it. In fact, Professor Negroponte came to my laboratory in Delhi, and we had, you know, sort of several chats. He too is aware of the hole in the wall. So his idea is to allow the collaboration to happen not over one public computer, but over a network of inexpensive computers. There are, according to me, there are two problems. Is an electronic network as good as a group of children standing together? In my experiment, what I saw was that they're working together physically, shoulder to shoulder, is extremely important to the learning process. But I think the $100 computer, I think what's necessary, very necessary at this point, is to do some measurements on its exact effects on children, instead of suddenly going and flooding the market with it. So I've been insisting on this with Professor Negroponte.
Hi, Professor Mitra. My name is Fred Destin. I'm just curious if you could expand a bit on the link between acquisition of values and use of technology. It really whetted my appetite, and I was curious to hear more.
Thanks for raising that question, because I was really rushing at that time to beat the clock. What I was trying to say is that technology is clearly affecting value systems in children. All of us know that, and all of us sort of we look at it with some amount of fear. We are kind of conditioned, I think, to think that it has to be bad. Remember television, when it came in, had exactly the same thing. I mean, just watching too much TV is bad. Playing with a computer is bad. So what I was trying to say is that if we know that technology can affect values, then instead of saying, let's take away technology from children, why don't we find methods by which technology can affect the values in the way in which you want those values to be affected? So I, as a technologist, will simply say that I'm interested in finding the means. What you do with it will be the job of the educator, to see how those values can be changed. But and the last bit over there is that since values clearly are acquired and not taught, computers seem to be extremely effective in sort of inculcating a value. For example, the hole in the wall, apart from whatever else it does, is extremely good for collaboration with children. They learn how to lead a structured discussion instead of a fight. They also learn the opposite of domination. See, when you have something physically and somebody else does not, then he can fight with you and take it away. But if you know something and the other person does not, then he has to make friends with you to take it away. And that's why this equation between the young children and the older children become completely different in a village when the hole in the wall is introduced. So I thought that it should be pursued, this line of thought should be pursued.
Hi, just a quick question. Do you have any ideas about similar experiences in, let's say, Africa, Latin America, or other parts of Asia?
Yes, I do. In fact, that movie which I cut short does exactly that. This experiment was repeated by the government of South Africa in Johannesburg slums and in East London. And they were in touch with me, but I sort of told them, you go ahead and do exactly what you want, because I want an independent opinion. And they independently verified and got precisely the same results, which of course made me feel very happy. And then the government of India repeated the experiments in Cambodia, in five villages in Cambodia, and again we got the exactly the same results. So it almost looks as though what we saw here is universal between 6 and 13, given a connected environment.
That's time. Thank you very much.